So let's talk about some more therapy. Cognitive therapy. Y'all now know plenty about cognitive theory. We talked about social cognitive theory. We talked about how biases form, schemas form, how that skews our processing of reality such that we are more likely to interpret it consistently with what we already believe it to be, regardless of the quote-unquote facts. Our perceptions are not pure translations of reality. They are constructed constructs of reality. We make them internally after perceiving things, and cognition matters. What you think matters. Now, the behaviorists were straight up, look at the behavior only, because it's operationalizable, right? You can be really concrete about what your operational definitions are. You can look at some very straightforward variables that are easy to measure, that are easy to manipulate, and easy to determine outcomes. There's a lot of utility in that, but they didn't care to study the old behaviors, the old school behaviors, didn't care to study cognition because they thought that's in the black box. Can't look at it, can't be objective about it. You can only rely on people to tell you what they're thinking, and they may not in fact know themselves what they're thinking or why they're thinking it, and they may not be entirely honest if they did know those things. So you don't have any guarantees of objectivity. However, we don't seriously consider for a moment that human beings aren't thinking animals. We're the highest thinking animals that we know of in the universe, and as such, what we think matters. And what we think skews our lives. It can skew it in a positive way, or it can skew it in a negative way. And that may change over time, and it may change moment to moment, but that we find that people have trends in the way they conceptualize the world, in their worldviews, and then we see that they have trends in the way they conceptualize themselves in terms of self-concept. And the way we conceptualize ourselves has a lot to do with whether or not we're happy or satisfied with the lives we lead, or the relationships that we're engaged in, or the opportunities that we see or don't see available to us. So looking at cognition, we're talking about changing thoughts. What kind of thoughts? The kind of thoughts that are usually automatic, the kind of thoughts that are usually schema-driven, the kind of thoughts that we don't normally challenge, we just assume the validity of. But we challenge them, and we find out that maybe they're not valid. But if they're unchallenged, they drive your reality. So rational emotive behavior therapy, REBT, is a really good one to know for your test. Thank y'all for coming today. Based on Albert Ellis's idea that we develop psychological disorders because of distorted thinking, that we have irrational and self-defeating beliefs. And then he connects the thinking to emotion. Originally, it was just RET, rational emotive therapy, where he says your emotions are reflections of your thinking. And then people criticize him for not talking about behavior. And of course, behavior was assumed. So he just added that in there. Rational emotive behavior therapy. It's now a really long, convoluted thing to say everything, right? But where he's really focused on what you're thinking and how that affects your emotions and how that affects your behaviors and ways that then you engage in behaviors that confirm your original thoughts. For example, and he was kind of an asshole the way he was presented by many people. He just seemed like an unfeeling, uncaring, just unrelenting challenger of every thought you had. But what he was doing was really not trying to make you feel dumb or make you feel inadequate, but to make you think about your thinking, because we don't usually think about our thinking. That's metacognition. To make you assess the validity of deeply held beliefs about yourself and the world. For example, if a person says, well, I'm really lonely. My life, I don't have anybody that cares about me, and I don't date anybody. I'm a loser. I'm nobody cares, and I'll never get a lover or a partner. And he would say, why is that? He's like, well, people just don't want to go out with me. And he might say, well, how many people have you asked out in the last year? And the person would, well, none. Well, why wouldn't you have asked anybody out? Well, because nobody would say yes. How do you know that nobody would say yes, right? How many people do you need to say yes? Well, one would be nice. Well, why don't you go and ask 100 people this week out? Well, I couldn't do that. You couldn't do it, or you wouldn't do it. Because if we were to put it to the test, and he's not saying you should go to the extreme, but what he's doing is challenge. If you asked, hypothetically, 100 people in a sincere manner, would you like to go out to dinner? What are the odds that one of them, assuming they were single, would say yes? They're pretty high. right? But the person's not actually challenging the belief. The person's actually doing everything they can to sustain the belief without challenging it. And that's the idea, is that a lot of our self-defeating ideas and self-defeating concepts are unchallenged, and they wouldn't be verified if we put them to tests. And so his point there is to think about your thinking, especially automatic negative thoughts. So I notice, for example, when I do something that I don't like, if I make a mistake, I'll say to myself, stupid, that was stupid. In other words, I will put myself down for making a mistake that if somebody else had made the mistake and they're like, oh, that's terrible, I'd go, oh, don't worry about it. Everybody makes mistakes, right? I would forgive them, but not myself. So becoming aware of a trend inside myself to negatively evaluate what I would consider for anybody else to be normal human error, I could then challenge whether or not that's valid. Sometimes I might concur, yeah, I should have known better, but other times I might concur, you know what, a lot of people know better, but we don't have attention that's fully capable of assessing every moment of our lives. I let it slip like everybody else did. I made a mistake, I'll fix it. That's very different than shoulding upon myself. And he would say, don't should upon yourself, right? Don't be shoulding on yourself, because we can make our lives very miserable if we're really guilty about what we should have done, right? And what you should be doing, instead of just going, well, what am I doing? And how can I be happy with that? And what are the ways in which I could engage life differently that might lead to different kinds of outcomes where I don't feel like I have to do it one particular way? Maybe there are lots of ways to be. So cognitive behavior therapy actually combines cognitive therapy and behavioral therapy more formally. But really, it's become a collection of tons of different techniques. It has a theoretical framework that is rooted originally in behaviorism and in cognitive psychology. But what you see is it comes together over time as an empirically supported treatment, meaning it is shown to be better than placebo at helping people deal with all kinds of issues if they will engage it with motivation, if they get somebody that they trust, if they then put forth the effort and stay with it long enough and apply these techniques, they find, on average, much improved experiences in the world. So you look at cognitive behavioral and you're like, well, where's emotion? Where's affect? Well, I can talk to you about your thoughts and you can assess your thoughts. You might even assess your emotions, but that's you thinking about your emotions, right? And I can talk to you about your behaviors and the kinds of things you do or don't do that you might do, but I can't tell you to feel differently, right? But if you change the way you think about yourself or situations, or you change the way you behave or engage situations so that you're improving your efficiency or your adaptivity, you're likely to feel better. So the idea is that you're triangulating. What you can manipulate should have a positive effect on what we consider to be our emotional state, that I should feel happier if I engage in a more positive lifestyle. Cognitive restructuring is just one of the technique therapies. There's really lots and lots that can fall under that. But basically, if I've got a maladaptive pattern of thought that's causing maladaptive behavioral responses, then the idea is to change it. But keep in mind, we don't change attitudes easily. You remember when we talked about social cognitive stuff, right? We talked about schemas and biases and attitude change and central route and peripheral route and things like that. When we have come to a lifetime of conclusions, we don't change those conclusions randomly or easily. So to change thoughts about yourself and how you think about the world and the way that you process information and engage in behavior is a difficult thing that requires effort and persistence. And it helps to have guidance. And just for your happy assessment, since you are trying to get better than 50% of them right, Aaron Beck is a big theorist in cognitive theory. So he is got the gold standard measure of depression. It's called the Beck Depression Inventory. And that's probably used across the world more than any other single measure for quantifying the level of somebody's depression. Self-report measure. You remember we talked about self-report measures of the objective kind in the personality chapter. That's a objective measure of depression. And Aaron Beck is well-known and well-respected for his work in the cognitive area of clinical psychology. Eclectic therapy is what you typically get now. Back in the old school days, you got trained in a paradigm. You were a psychoanalyst, for example, or you were a behaviorist, for example, or you were a gestalt psychologist, or you were a family systems person, or you were whatever your dominant paradigm of the graduate program was when you were done with the graduate program. But that was before we had lots and lots of research accumulate, which shows that some therapies are more effective at treating some disorders than are others. And over time, what you see now is an amalgam where very rarely is somebody trained only in a paradigm. And if they are trained only in a paradigm, it's usually cognitive behavior, because cognitive behavioral is so broad, it includes a lot of elements from a lot of other therapies, so that what we see is people are being trained in what's effective, not just in a theoretical orientation. We should expect people to engage in therapeutic activities that are shown to work better than placebo.